Dark Souls is such an easy game. I mean, you have your pyromancies, your unga bunga, but people still complain and say it needs an easy mode. Well, guess what? There is an easy mode in this game, and it's hidden in plain sight. This is Dark Souls, but baby easy mode, aka sorceries only. We start off with a sorcerer class and take the master key. We name her Mana because I'm original, and we're off. So what are the rules of this run? Well, it's beat every boss using sorceries only. We don't need to use any of them swords or axes. Those are for people who want to play on normal difficulty. We pick up our catalyst, then take on the asylum demon. Let's see how much damage we do. Oh, it's beautiful, isn't it? After everything I've went through in these games, it's so nice to do actual damage for once. It took 10 soul arrows to bring down the asylum demon. I want you to think about that. It took 10 hits of our basic sorcery to kill a boss. Admittedly the tutorial boss, but to put it another way, we pressed R1 10 times and won. Still think this game doesn't have an easy mode? Don't worry, it gets better. At Firelink, we start making our way towards the Taurus Demon, but we do need to be a little careful. For as powerful as spells are in this game, they do have one weakness. Limited spell cast. This can be fixed by either obtaining more powerful spells or multiple copies of the same spell, but for now we need to be mindful and basically not kill anything except for bosses. We stop by the undead merchant to buy the residence key, then do old faithful Undeadburg skip. The reason why is so we can free Griggs of Vinheim. Well, why do we want to do that, you ask? Because he sells spells. Obviously. Effectively negating the problem I literally talked about 5 sentences ago. We buy both Heavy Soul Arrow and an extra copy of Regular Soul Arrow, which gives us a whopping 72 attacks before needing to rest. Yeah, I don't think any early game boss fight's gonna be an issue anymore. On our way, we Donkey Kong our way over this barrel and take out the 2 snipers. 67 attacks left. Let's see how we do. Yeah, that's about a 1/7 of his health with 1 attack. I think we're fine. Okay, so there is one other problem with this run you can start to see here. FromSoft knew that sorceries were baby easy mode, so they decided that the more damage a spell could do, the slower it gets casted. It's something to keep in mind going forward because the windows to attack on bosses are going to get smaller and smaller. For now though, we head under the Hellkite Drake and do our best at trying to free aim spells. It doesn't go so well. Eventually we land a hit and oh yeah, he's magic resistant. Okay, that's fine, I know his true weakness. Windows. Equipping a second staff just for the coolness factor, it's up to fight the gargoyles. We actually used quite a bit of our soul arrow cast to take on the hollows in the hallway, but yeah, it's not something I really need to worry about. A few soul arrows later and they go down and we ring the first bell. Back in Firelink, I spot Lautrec and think his ring would look much nicer on my finger than his. Unfortunately, I can't give him his canonical death because my foot is not magic, but it's nothing a few soul arrows to the face can't fix. Down through New Londo and into everyone's favorite swampland, Blighttown, we face our greatest enemy yet, Temptation. I guess From did put a hard mode in the game, if you know what I mean. Quaylag isn't really an issue, especially because we added Great Heavy Soul Arrow to our lineup. We only get 8 casts of it, but it knocks off most of her health, and then regular soul arrows pick up the slack. Before long, Spider Bay falls. Next up, Ceaseless Discharge. Yep. With both bells rung, we could climb the Forbidden Funhouse, but first I wanted to make a quick pit stop to buy the Bellowing Dragon Crest Ring, then to Darkroot Basin to kill a Hydra. We do this for the Duskcrown Ring, which might be useful, but more importantly to free Dusk to set up the DLC, and for the Duskcrown. The ring will increase our total spell cast at the cost of half our HP, but the crown will increase our magic damage. Well, it actually increases our magic adjust stat, but potato potato, it makes the number bigger. Now it's finally time to ascend Sin's Fortress. Normally, we just run to the top and kick the Iron Golem in the shins, but we actually need to bust Big Hat Logan out of prison. Thankfully, the Master Key works on this cage. For some reason. The Iron Golem isn't an issue. He's really slow, and apparently Iron is weak to magic typing. Don't remember learning that in Pokemon. 6 Great Heavy Soul Arrows later, he goes down and we end up in Anor Londo. There isn't much to say about Anor Londo. We do this cool speedrunning strat for style points, then watch this Bat Demon forget how to fly. The Silver Knight is, I'm good at this game, I swear. The Dream Team is up next, and let me tell you, we have 47 intelligence, so we hit like a truck. But so do they. So here's the thing about ONS in this kind of run. Ornstein is programmed to dodge out of the way of projectiles, so trying to hit him from far away is not really gonna work. We need to hit him after or during his attack animation. Fortunately, this game is pretty slow overall compared to the later entries, so that's doable. Unfortunately, I suck.
We could have just downed Smough in phase 1. I mean, he doesn't dodge, but I like fighting the super version of him. After dropping Ornstein like a sack of potatoes, Super Smough is up. Side note, in all of my years of this game, I have never seen this animation cancel. I'm sure it's not useful for anything like speedrunning, but it's still cool to see something new in this game. Smough died, and it's up to see Guinevere, Queen of Sunlight, and why was I here again? With the Lord Vessel in hand, we warp back to Firelink and buy Soul Spear, Great Soul Arrow, and Heavy Soul Arrows from Big Hat Logan. We do the stanky leg, then head off to the Duke's Archives because you know what? If I'm gonna showcase how easy being a mage is, we might as well full send it. So we're gonna pick up the Broken Pendant, then it's off to Darkroot Basin to get yanked by Manus and face off with the Sanctuary Guardian. This fight is usually not an issue, but admittedly we are struggling a bit because we have no health or armor. And I also just realized we never upgraded our Estus Flask. Oops. But where we're going, we don't need Estus Flask, because pretty much everything one hits us anyway. Four Soul Spears is enough to wipe out the majority of his health, then we finish him off with one Great Heavy Soul Arrow. Up next, though, is a fight I wasn't worried about before, but after that little fiasco, I'm a bit worried now. Should probably have more than 8 vitality. 9. Yeah, 9 is good. The legend himself, Knight Artorias. So I went into this fight with one fear, that quickly became two fear. First, as you know, Artorias hits like a truck. So that's the first issue. If we get hit, we either immediately die or are really close to it. Okay, so we just have to do it hitless basically. That's not so bad. We just need to dodge and land our shots. Oh. Ah yeah, that's a problem. Yeah, my second fear is that Artorias is programmed to dodge projectiles. It's not impossible to hit him, but it means our windows are even smaller. We basically need to dodge as early as possible in his attack, and then immediately fire off a spell. Soul Spear and Soul Arrow are fast enough to do this, but Great Heavy Soul Arrow? No, not at all. So what's the plan? Well, Soul Spear actually hits decently hard, so we need to land all four of those, then we need to land a large majority of Soul Arrows to whittle him down to minimize the amount of time casting our stupid slow spell. In the end though, we lucked out and Artorias decided to rebuff, giving us just enough time to fire off a few Great Heavy Soul Arrows and win. Next up, the real boss of this game, Ulysseal Township. I hate this place. Legitimately. The run through this area actually killed me more times than Artorias did. I mean, good on From for making an area where they were so heavily aware of the routes players would take and making it difficult for them, but man, this place sucks. We cast Light, grab the Silver Pendant, mine the gap, die, reload, then grab the Crest Key. I am kidding! We died like 7 more times between those last two things. Eventually, we make our way down to the Chasm of the Abyss. Do you see it? Can you feel the power radiating off that light over there? So close, we murder the 4 remaining enemies between us and an ultimate power, and here it is. Darkbead. So, what is Darkbead? Well, the first answer is broken, but the real answer is a sorcery that deals physical and magical damage. It has 6 casts and takes up 1 slot. Upon firing it, 7 small beads will fly out in a horizontal cone shape in front of you and absolutely wreck anything. Yeah, do you remember what I said earlier about the stronger the sorcery, the slower it casts? Yeah, FromSoft kinda threw that out the window with this one. Here, it might be easier for me to show you. Thank you, Capper Demon, for volunteering. Did you catch that? Here, I'll play it again. Now that's what I call speed. To be completely fair, we do have 50 int and stat boosting gear on, but come on, that's still ridiculous. I mean, we still have 5 more casts of this spell. Okay, we'll try it on a boss with a little more health. How about the Capper Demon? Broken. This spell is so broken, in fact, it can actually softlock you, but I'll talk about that later. For now, I have unlimited power and wanted to kill something even bigger, so we head back to the Undead Asylum via Crotaxi and take on the Stray Demon. This big chunker of a boy takes a whopping 3 casts to kill. 3! I hit R1 3 times and he died! In fact, I basically hit R1 6 times and killed 3 bosses. In this game that is considered by many to be quite difficult, I hit 1 button 6 times and killed 14% of the game's bosses. Still don't think this is baby easy mode? The absolutely bonkers thing is we aren't anywhere near the amount of damage we could be doing. There are 3 other items that could boost us even higher. The Red Tier Stone Ring, Power Within, and the 10 Crystallization Catalyst. Power Within boosts our attack by 40%, but it's a pyromancy, so we can't use it if our goal is to only use sorceries. RTSR boosts our attack by 50% when below 20% of our max HP, but since I'm trying to show how easy this game can be, that kind of health management would fly directly in the face of the game being too easy. Lastly, the 10 Crystallization Catalyst increases our spell damage, but halves our spell cast. It's a reward for finishing Big Hat Logan's questline, and we will be picking it up for the extra damage. To be honest, the rest of this video could just be a boss-killing montage. I mean, we've basically become Death Destroyer of Worlds, but there are a few funny things that happen along the way. I'll skip through the bosses pretty quickly until things pick up again. Demon Fire Sage held on through 3 Dark Beads and thought he was gonna make an anime comeback with that little amount of health? Nope. The Centipede Demon is a joke and would have died in 2 hits, but he has the ultimate thigh gap. Honestly, this right here is the only issue with this spell at all. Since the beads it sends out are decently small, you actually need to be right next to something to hit it for full damage. That being said, the strategy for most bosses is just bury your face in its ass and slash at its ankles anyway, so it's mostly a non-issue. The Bed of Chaos does a Bed of Chaos things. We don't even waste a cast of Darkbeat on it, and instead it dies to a single soul arrow. Pinwheel is... Pinwheel. I almost feel bad for him. I mean, he's a joke in a normal run. He stood absolutely no chance this time around. Nito starts off a bit rocky because his skelly boys are in the way. I had a smart plan to wipe them out in one shot, but I missed. The second plan of standing in his face and hitting R1 3 times works though. For Moonlight Butterfly, I opted to use Soul Sphere because I didn't know if he was too far away to hit with all the beads, and I just didn't want him to come any closer. Sif goes the way of old Yeller. Too soon, I know. We take our mandatory death from Seath and get thrown in jail. All we have to do is kill this Serpent Man to get the key, and then we can... Okay, that's a problem. So you can't hit this Serpent Man with normal cast. I don't know how, but this itty-bitty cell blocks my big old magic attacks. Fortunately, I pick up Dark Fog earlier, which places a hitbox outside of the cage, letting us escape. I could have just whacked him with my stick, but I thought this was a clever use of sorceries. Oh, this is my favorite part! We free Big Hat Logan so we could buy Crystal Soul Spear and upgrade our already ridiculous Soul Spear spell. Seath is actually pretty resistant to magic. Believe it or not, it took us 8 R1 presses to kill him. Crazy, I know. We use his souls to buy all the remaining spells from Logan so he'll go insane. Why do all these NPC quests in this game end so badly? Back in Seath's old bedroom, hey look, my souls. The now naked and afraid Logan awaits us. We trade spells and he goes down netting us our prize. The 10 Crystallization Catalyst. Like I said earlier, this catalyst has the cool effect of increasing our sorcery damage. Unfortunately, it also halves our spell cast, so Darkbeat is reduced to 3 and both soul spears are down to 2. Fortunately, we have a way to counter this. The Dust Crown Ring will double our spell cast. In this case, it just restores them to their original numbers, but at the cost of half our max HP. To be honest, I was debating using this or not. Having half health does kind of pull away from baby easy mode, putting the game solidly in toddler easy mode, but it's fine. Up next is the 4 Kings, and this is where we hit a bit of a snag. You see, to even stand in their arena, you have to be wearing the Covenant of Artorias. Basically, we need to decide which ring to replace. Removing the Dust Crown would reduce our spell cast, and removing the Ring of Favor and Protection would reduce our health, stamina, and equipment load, and it breaks upon removing it. Ultimately, I decided to take off the Fap Ring because I wanted to bump up my damage with the Bellowing Dragon Crest Ring anyway, so with that, we plunge into the Abyss. Each King takes 2 casts to kill. I'd show you the full fight, but because they spawn on a 45-second timer and we kill them in about 3 seconds, it's a lot of nothing. 6 casts later and that's all the lords down. Back in Firelink, I noticed we were mid-rolling. I guess the bump from the Fap Ring actually helped. Fortunately, we got enough souls to level Endurance 3 times and we returned to Nimble. There are a couple more optional bosses we need to take care of, so we head back to the catacombs to grab the Darkmoon Seance Ring to make our way to Anorlondo. With this, we can access Gwyndolin without hurting the illusionary Booba Lady. Gwyndolin's fight took longer than the other bosses, not because he's hard, but because we had to run him down. 2 R1s later and we have an eternal curse put upon us. To reflect on our transgressions, we admire some artwork. No, not that artwork! That goes in the homework folder. This artwork. Sucked into the painted world of Ariamis, you know what to do. Jump the fence, open the gate, wave at the goopy boys, re-dead the undead dragon, and then... have an existential crisis about what to do next. Normally, we just jump attack the butt to glitch it to stand up so we can walk by it, but this catalyst can't jump attack. Also, jumping attack's not a sorcery. So, my options were either go through the sewers with all the Will Skelly Bros and keep this a pure sorcery only run, or unequip the catalyst and jump attack with our fists to keep this a baby easy mode run. In the end, I sided with the jump attack because, well, I honestly didn't want to go through the sewers. I mean, have you been to that place? It sucks. We enter the chambers of Crossbreed Priscilla and, What? So you remember how I said Darkbead was so broken it could actually softlock your game? Well, if you use stat boosting gear here and one-shot Priscilla with it, there's a chance she'll actually get stuck in a death loop and you're unable to leave the arena. There are actual speedruns dedicated to this. It's called Moan Percent, which, don't look that up without safe search on, kids. At any rate, to make absolutely sure that doesn't happen, I open with our weakest spell, Soul Spear. Then the camera actually tracks her through her invisibility and we ping her with a dark bead to end the fight. Good night, queen. We throw ourselves off a cliff, the only appropriate reaction after killing Priscilla, and just like that, we're back in Anorlondo. We only have 3 bosses left, so we check in on Guinevere for, luck. Then it's off to Horny Jail. So I'll be honest, even though this is a baby easy mode, Manus is still a spike in difficulty. He hits pretty hard, doesn't take a whole lot of damage from a full dark beat, and he can even occasionally jump out of the way of our soul spear spells. In the end though, it still only took us 9 R1s, including the one that I missed, to take him down. In a normal run, Calamite is really difficult. Similar to Manus, he has a lot of health, has big sweeping attacks that do a lot of damage, but because we're a sorcerer, we can just kind of stand out of range and hit him. It took us 9 spells, including the one that we missed here, to kill him as well. For those of you not counting, that's 18 R1s to kill the 2 bosses considered to be hardest in this game. Finally, it is time. We drop our Lord Souls into the bowl and descend into the kiln of the first flame. Gwyn, Lord of Cinder, awaits us. This man, this god, defeated the dragons and ushered in the Age of Fire. Surely a worthy challenge. Nope. Baby easy mode, everybody. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. I know everyone and their mother has done a sorcery only video, so I hope you enjoyed my spin on it. It was a nice break from the actual difficult challenges I've been doing recently. If you did like it, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It helps me out way more than you know. And also drop your suggestions for what kind of video I should do next in the comments. I'd love to hear them. Until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow.